Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Venom Vlog. And today we have another Versus episode for Venom. It is Venom versus Nightwatch. I remember when this comic came out in the 90s, and it was like 94-ish, somewhere around there. And I was kind of into it. The concept is pretty neat. It's like a suit that travels like from the future. So it's like a guy in the future comes to the past and leaves his suit for his past self to get. And so in this story, he's like basically going to these locations where they're creating his suit. It's not even finished being built yet. And yet here he is wearing it. And he's interacting with these people that, you know, used to be a part of his life. And he's dealing with his uncle who thought he was dead, you know, and all this stuff. And so it's pretty neat. It's a neat concept. I liked it overall. It's kind of Spawn-ish in a way, but without the soul and the demon stuff and, you know, hell and all that. It's more of a technological suit, like an Iron Man thing with nanotech, but it has like a Spawn approach like to it. They're all African-American characters, you know, themselves, like the, you know, Nightwatch is a black guy, obviously. And so his story kind of starts off with him trying to get answers, trying to figure out what's going on, you know, what the suit can do, what it can't do. And only 5 issues into his story, I don't know if it's because they wanted to boost sales or whatever, because at this point, obviously, Venom was a big deal, and he had his own series, you know, happening in San Francisco, which is where this takes place. Nightwatch finds out that there's a branch of this group called Morel Pharmaceuticals or something that had something to do with his suit, and this woman named Fox and, like, a couple other characters that, you know, work at this lab and stuff. And he's like trying to figure out answers to this. Or Fox is like this lady who works with Cardiac or something like that. And they're trying to find Nightwatch as well. So there's like all these like side plots going on. But meanwhile, you know, Nightwatch is trying to get some answers. And he goes to San Francisco to get involved. And there's this woman that gets there's like an explosion at a lab in San Francisco. And it's a lab that, you know, is similar to the one that created Nightwatch. So he's like, oh, I'm interested. Let's go see what this is all about. And when he arrives, this woman, the scientist who was working in the lab, she was part of that research when the explosion happened. And she developed powers, and she became a character named Sunstreak. And as you know, like sun and fire is like can weaken Venom. So when Venom shows up, he's actually kind of smart about how he approaches attacking this lady. And he shows up pretty quick because he's the protector of San Francisco. So when someone shows up just shooting fire everywhere, you know, and it's not Funeral Pyre, it's not the character from Funeral Pyre, he's like, all right, I got to find out what this is about. So when he shows up and he sees this lady, they get into it. And so the battle first starts with them two fighting. And Venom actually gets a couple good licks in, but when he knocks her off a roof or out of a building, that's when Nightwatch shows up. And he's like, all right, I tracked, you know, this source here. I found her powers, and I believe she might have some answers because she blew up at a lab similar to the lab that created my suit or that it's working on my suit right now. And so I want to try to get some answers from her. And then when he shows up, though, you know, she's like, hey, I'm not a damsel in distress. And she hits him and weakens him. And then Venom shows back up to like fight her, and he can't really do much to stop it. But then they try to suffocate each other, although the art is a little iffy here because she shows a bubble over his face. But when Venom tries to like cover her face, the art doesn't show it. And I feel like that's kind of lazy. Like the artist should have showed exactly what Venom was doing to her face. Like if he was covering her to suffocate or something, I was like, ah, come on, man, you could draw that, you know, because the art in this book's pretty good. It's written by Terry Cavanaugh, and then Mark Tenney is actually the artist on it. And he does a pretty good job. So I was actually surprised to see how, you know, why he didn't do it. Or maybe if like another artist filled in on that page or that panel just to get the book out on time. You never know with these things. Or maybe he tried to draw and he couldn't. If he got frustrated and he just drew the back of her head while her face was getting covered. And it's like, you know, it's a comic. Show it. You know, don't have people go, hey, I'm choking you. And then not show the choke, you know, or something. Or at least, you know, show a good angle for it or something. So that's kind of how I felt about it. You know, this is a little critique there. But then you have his uncle Drake here, who is, you know, still not believing that his nephew could be alive. And so there's like a whole drama thing going on with that. And then meanwhile, they do something really cool. And this Terry Cavanaugh has Eddie be an actual investigative journalist. So he's thinking about, you know, Nightwatch. He's like, what's going on? Where does this guy come from? He's seeing like things on, you know, online and looking up. He's at the public library looking up newspapers and stuff. He's trying to figure out about the Morel Pharmaceutical Company. And he's learning all these things. And because he's Eddie Brock and he's figured out the Watergate scandal as a kid, you know, in front of his dad, he's capable. And he's actually figures out what's going on. And he's like, you know what? I believe this guy who's given this interview for this, you know, for what's happening, who works at Morel, he might actually be full of crap. And so I'm going to go pay him a visit as Venom. And when he shows up as Venom, he turns out to be right. And he gets some answers out of this guy while Nightwatch is out, you know, going to different labs trying to figure out what's going on. And he actually shows up at the lab that is creating the very suit that he's wearing. And so it's pretty neat. And everyone in there is like, we don't understand. How is he wearing our suit when we're not even done with it yet? So again, playing with that time travel element that the story is kind of, focuses around. But then at that point, that's when Venom gets the answers he needs, and he kind of realizes that Nightwatch might actually be, an ally to him. So when he shows up next to save or to confront Nightwatch, it's as an ally and not as a villain. But at this time is when Nightwatch gets taken down by these silent shadow creatures at the very end, like these like robot ninja guys. And then it carries over into issue 6 of Nightwatch. So it's a two-part story, even though this is all still the first 6 issues are all still kind of the origin of Nightwatch, because this, and I gotta give it to Terry Cavanagh for tying in a Venom appearance while he was still telling the origin of his character, and Venom's not even a character connected to Nightwatch in any way, but this was kind of neat to do that. So it's pretty cool. And again, it's Eddie Brock using his brain and telling the suit. There's not a lot of interaction between Eddie and the suit in this one, which again kind of bums me. I hate when writers don't do that, because that's kind of the thing with Venom, is to get inside his head and see that. But this is Nightwatch's book, so it's kind of neat to see Venom through Nightwatch's point of view. Although that's also another reason to do the Eddie Brock talking to Venom thing, because then he would look crazier in front of Nightwatch. Like if Eddie was sitting there or talking to himself as Venom, then Nightwatch would be like, what's going on? And he's just like, oh, my suit's alive. And he's like, okay, your suit's alive. That could have added just a couple of moments of humor there. Although they might have done that in Maximum Carnage, maybe that's why Terry Cavanagh didn't retread on that here. But still, that's kind of the beauty of writing the character in another book, is that you can have those moments and have the your main character, like in this case Nightwatch, kind of look at Eddie and be like, something's off about that guy. But obviously we know that, because look at how awesome he looks. He looks a little off, but he's still awesome to us. So anyway, so they fight the ninjas, they take them down. And then you have this lady, Ashley St. Croix, and she's the one who kind of helps create the suit. And Nightwatch saves her, almost revealing a little bit too much about himself. And she's like, what's with the costume? How do you have the suit? And after they fight down the silent ninjas, Eddie Brock comes out with her and him, and kind of sticks around for some answers. But then Eddie's like, all right, this isn't my scene. You saved the girl. The bad guys are gone. I'm going to let you continue. My city better be safe from now on. I'm going to go, back to work, scouring my city and making sure it is safe. So, Nightwatch, do what you need to do. Talk to this lady and get the heck out of my town. And that's pretty much what Nightwatch does, is, he was thinking about removing his mask and talking to her, but talking to Ashley and revealing, because she's someone from his past. Like they used to be like a couple. And he's like, whatever. Like I need to keep my identity hidden from her, because I already saw how my uncle reacted when I revealed who I was. And this lady actually made this suit. I don't want to reveal too much about us and our connection to each other. And I don't want her, to be invested in me and know too much about me right now, because I still need to get answers. And it's at this time Venom actually shows back up and says, hey, before the place blew up, I actually saved a disc, a drive about your suit. So if you want answers, here they are. But leave the woman alone. She's an innocent, and she actually tried to do something heroic today and try to save us and give us answers. But without putting her life on the line and making her reveal too much, here's a disc, and Venom gives it to Nightwatch, webs him up to a tree or a series of trees, and says this will give the woman time to get away. Like Ashley will get away now. And Nightwatch's like, no, like I can break out of this. And he's struggling. And when he finally breaks out, Ashley's long gone and Venom's long gone. But at least he has the drive. And so he takes it to his uncle, and his uncle, forgives him for everything that's been going on, says, I understand why maybe you didn't tell me you're still alive, but, so I may forgive you, but, we'll still are going to have our differences. He goes, but while you were, resting today, I took a look at your hard drive and I found out some answers about your suit and maybe, some of the things that's going on. But meanwhile, the device was bugged and it, self-destructs, and you find out that Dr. Morell was the one behind that. And he actually, saw that the drive was getting away. So he, somehow rigged it before Venom could take it. And then while he's doing that, you reveal also that actually St. Croix is now his current, woman, I guess, like they're together. And she, he talks about, she's still fixated on her first love. He's out of the picture now. And so now it's me and her, our time together. And so you can see that this bad guy, Dr. Morell, is, kind of has Ashley, even though she's a good person, but he's making her think, he's kind of doing the Lex Luthor thing where he's like making her think he's a good person too. But he is also covering his bases and trying to take down Nightwatch, who, we find out later in the story when those two cross paths again, they learn each other's identities and they get into the whole thing. But for here, the story kind of ends with his Night Watch and his uncle kind of reconnecting, and then looking at the, after looking at the drive, trying to get answers. And they're like, all right, they may have taken down the house that we were in, but don't worry, we still have another place we can go, and we have a mission now, and we can and we have a target now with Dr. Morell, so let's go after him. And then so that's where the book kind of ends. But then you have this lady, Killian Fox, and she shows up at Dr. Wortham's lab. And Dr. Wortham is the guy who was at the beginning of the story, who is cardiac, but it's in like a new form of cardiac. Cardiac's normally blue, but cardiac now is like charging up, and he has a secret office in his building where he's like charging up. And this is a character I love that Dan Slott brought in later on in Amazing Spider-Man and kind of turned him into a kind of a anti-hero slash good guy. But in this time in the comics, he was kind of more of a bad guy. So it's pretty neat. This book has a mostly African-American cast. Like most of the characters are, I think Ashley and Dr. Dr. Morell are kind of the, and Eddie Brock in this case, are like the only white people in the book. So I, at a young age, like I was reading a lot of these things and I was like, wow, there's a lot of cool, black superheroes in comic books. So that I was already exposed to Jon Stewart and I liked him a lot. And then obviously War Machine, Rhodey, and then Bishop on the X-Men and stuff, and Storm, who I had like the biggest fictional crush. He was like one of my first fictional crushes was Storm. And so when I was reading these characters, like, hey, this is great. Like, Night Watch seems like an interesting concept, an interesting character, someone who jumps in and tries to help out at the wrong times and sometimes for the wrong reasons and selfish reasons, but he knows that and he learns from that. And so he's like a flawed character, but he's a growing character as well. And I like the approach. I thought Terry Cavanaugh and the people that worked on this book did a really good job. And I actually had at one point the entire run of Night Watch. I don't anymore. So I had to buy these on like Amazon, or maybe I bought them on Mile High Comics for like $1 an issue or something like that. But I used to have the entire run of Night Watch. I really liked the character a lot. And to the point where they were announcing a potential movie like not too long ago, I was like, all right, like if you're going to make a Night Watch movie that crossover over with Morbius and Venom and stuff like that, I'd be down to watch that. That'd be a cool addition to that little universe because it's different. It's a different type of hero. It involves like minor time travel story elements. So it could have worked, on some levels. It's a guy who gives himself a suit from the future, goes back in time and says, here, you be the hero now. And I'm too old to be the superhero anymore, so I'm going to give it to my younger self. So, I don't know, I kind of like that. I thought that added something unique and different to the story, and it made me interested in the character. So when Venom crossed over, and as soon as issue 5 and 6, I really dug it. So I definitely wanted to make an issue about it, or an episode here about it, to share it with you guys. I think these are reprinted in the Venom Omnibus. I think you can find these two issues maybe in there. But I think that's the only place, because I don't think they exist digitally. I don't think any of the Night Watch stuff exists on Comixology at all. So if you work in Marvel and you're out there, please change that. Upload some of these issues to Comixology so people can check them out, because I think Night Watch is a cool character. Or at least if a movie is going to happen, re-release a trade paperback with like the first 10 issues or so in it, because I think that'd be pretty cool. But anyway, that's my thoughts on these. This is Venom versus Night Watch. Not really a big battle. They fight a little bit in the first issue, but then they pretty much team up right after that, like almost immediately after that, because Eddie Brock actually uses his brain in the story and cuts through the BS and works out something with Night Watch, finds a common goal, and they work at it together and they succeed. So less of a versus and more of a team up, but still a pretty effective one. And Venom did get a few shots in at the beginning, so still get a little bit of that. But like any team up in comics, it always starts off as a fight and eventually turns into a team up. But let me know what you think of this. I know you probably can't track down these issues, so I try to cover what I could, as much as I could in this episode. But if there's anything you want clarity on or anything you think I missed, if you have read them, let me know down in the comments below. We'll continue our conversation down there. Thanks so much for watching my show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And we'll see you in the future. Peace.